Having discussed mutations, point mutations in general, let's look at a very famous case of a point mutation that results in a particular disease, namely sickle cell disease. The normal hemoglobin B, the beta hemoglobin amino acid sequence is shown here with the corresponding codons found in the normal allele of that hemoglobin B gene. Now, hemoglobin is a tetramer of four subunits, four protein subunits. So there are four monomers in this tetramer. And there are two alpha subunits and two beta subunits per hemoglobin molecule. And each of these is capable of carrying an oxygen around in red blood cells. So hemoglobin is responsible for oxygen transport in your blood, in human blood. And the normal beta subunit, the normal beta protein in its amino terminal region has this sequence of amino acids in it. And there is a mutation that causes sickle cell disease in which a codon which encodes glutamine, I'm sorry, glutamic acid, a charged polar amino acid, a codon GAG, is mutated such that the codon is now GTG, or it would be GUG in the mRNA. And that causes the insertion of a valine in the place of a glutamic acid in the amino acid sequence of the beta globin, of the beta globin protein. And valine, as you may remember, is a hydrophobic amino acid, whereas, as I've said, glutamic acid is a polar charged amino acid. And that glutamate resides on the surface of the beta globin protein. But now we have inserted, due to mutation, a valine amino acid. This is, in other words, a missense mutation. We've inserted a valine amino acid in the mutant of caused by the mutant or allele, the sickle cell disease allele. And that valine, being hydrophobic on the surface, wants to hide away from water. It's a hydrophobic amino acid, whereas glutamate is hydrophilic. And that creates these sticky nonpolar sites on the surface of beta globin. And those valine nonpolar sites, the sticky nonpolar sites, hide away from water by embedding themselves in other beta globin molecules in various tetramers. And this results not in the individual hemoglobin tetramers floating around in red blood cells, but in low oxygen situations where you have a deoxygenated tetramer not carrying oxygen, that yields the association of tetramers by the association of hydrophobic valines on the surface of beta globins in hydrophobic pockets of the mutated beta globins of these tetramers. And that results in long chains of beta globin, I'm sorry, of hemoglobin molecules, which in a way form cables of hemoglobin tetramers that are associated with each other, long associations that are not formed in the normal case. And that transforms under low oxygen conditions where the tetramers are deoxygenated, not carrying oxygen. That causes a deformation of the red blood cells from their normal disc round shapes to sickle cell shapes due to the elongated chains of hemoglobin polymers, if you will, that are caused by polymerization of the tetramers due to this hydrophobic abnormal situation. And that transformation of red blood cell shape into sickle shape cells instead of round cells causes these sickle-shaped red blood cells to jam up the fine capillaries in the extremities, and this leads to oxygen deprivation in tissues and can even lead to death in severe cases. Now, however, this is an example. You might wonder, well, if that's what I've just said is true, why wouldn't natural selection have eliminated the allele that causes the disease of sickle cell anemia caused by the sickling of these red blood cells? Why wouldn't natural selection have eliminated that allele? And The answer to that is that, and you may have heard this before, is that if we were to plot fitness under normal circumstances of the heterozygote, so here's the sickle cell disease. We'll say here's the sickle cell disease wild type allele over the sickle cell disease wild type normal allele. So these are the normal alleles of hemoglobin. And we were to plot fitness of that, we would say, well, those are normal individuals that have normal hemoglobins and they have a high fitness, relative fitness. And if we look at individuals that are sickle cell disease mutant over sickle cell disease mutant, that is, carry this abnormal allele, they have very low fitness relative to the normal individuals. And the individuals that are heterozygous, that are sickle cell disease gene or hemoglobin B gene wild type over the mutant, have an intermediate fitness. They still have a wild type allele, so they're able to carry their red blood cells are not all going to sickle under low oxygen or deoxygenated conditions. So this would be the situation, let's say, in, I don't know, Europe. However, if you were to look in sub-Saharan Africa or other tropical regions in which malaria is present, and now plot the fitness of these three genotypes. Here we have the wild type homozygotes, the heterozygotes, and the homozygous mutants. What you find is that the fitnesses change so that the heterozygotes actually have a relative fitness advantage over the homozygotes. And that's because this heterozygous phenotype imbues individuals with that genotype with a malarial resistance. That is resistance to malaria. And for that reason, we believe that the hemoglobin B mutation, the beta hemoglobin mutation, which causes sickle cell disease in homozygous individuals, actually in heterozygous individuals, endows those individuals with resistance to malaria, which is a horrible killer of people that are subjected to infection by the malarial parasite borne by mosquitoes. And so here we have what we call this is heterozygous advantage. The heterozygote actually has an advantage over the homozygous, certainly here, but even over the homozygous wild type. So this is a famous example of heterozygous advantage in human populations and explains why the beta globin mutation that causes sickle cell disease is actually maintained at a fairly high frequency in certain human populations. Now let's move on to other types of mutations, moving beyond point mutations, and talk about frameshift mutations. We've looked at the phenomenon of frameshifting when we looked at the experiments which led to the discovery that the genetic code is a triplet code by Crick and Brenner. So if you have mutations that cause the addition or deletion of a single base, then that can shift the reading frame of the messenger RNA such that from the point of insertion or deletion, different amino acids are inserted compared to the normal wild type allele. And that is because the reading frame is shifted by the addition or deletion of bases. And these are have very profound consequences because from the point of insertion of a base on, there are wrong amino acids that are inserted. And where they alter the reading frame downstream of the insertion or the deletion. Now, there are also frameshift mutations that are caused by repeats of triplets of nucleotides that are expanded greatly in particular mutations. For example, Huntington's disease. And there, the repeat of triplet nucleotides is expanded. There are many more repeats found than in wild type, and that can cause a frame shift and result in Huntington's disease, which is a disease of a neuromuscular disease. Now, in addition to frameshift mutations there and point mutations, which are changes in the nucleic acid sequences of genes, we have chromosomal level mutations that aren't just mutations necessarily in a single gene, but which affect can affect multiple genes in large gene regions, large genomic regions. And one type of chromosomal mutation is a deletion, where part of a chromosome is actually lost. And therefore, the genes that are found in that part of the chromosome that is lost are not present, which can obviously create a loss of genetic function. Now, there are also duplications of parts of the genome in which part of a chromosome is present in an extra copy. And that leads to gene product imbalance, which can also have consequences for an organism. An inversion is when a part, the genomic region, is inverted in order in the gene order of a chromosome. And translocations are when part of a chromosome, part of one chromosome is translocated to another chromosome, another homologous set of chromosomes. So here's an example of a deletion, where this chromosome, where we're designating genomic regions by letters on a chromosome. Here's the centromere shown. In this case, we've deleted B, C, and D regions of the chromosome. They are missing in the resulting deletion chromosome. Duplications, on the other hand, we have duplications of genomic regions. Inversions, we see here an inversion of the B, C, D region, so that now we go from A to D, and then C, then B, and then back to E. This is an inversion. And if you look in natural populations of various organisms, you actually find numbers of inversion chromosomes. For example, Drosophila natural populations carry certain inversions at a measurable frequency. And here is an example of a reciprocal a translocation in which part of this chromosome is translocated to this chromosome and vice versa, so that now we have the top chromosome now has KLM from this chromosome as part of its genetic sequence, and ABC has been translocated reciprocally to the other chromosome. So we've changed the chromosomal arrangement of genes in the genome. And for inversions and for translocations, if the break that occurs that at the translocation breakpoint alters gene function, then that can result in a mutation, can alter gene function. And there's a famous chromosome in is present in a relatively high frequency in Philadelphia. It's called the Philadelphia chromosome. And that translocation actually predisposes individuals to cancer, because the translocation breakpoint places an oncogene under abnormal control, and that oncogene is overexpressed, then results in cancer. Now, we know that mutations are a starting point for evolution. We've mentioned this already, because mutations are the ultimate source of genetic variation upon which natural selection acts. But most mutations, in fact, are harmful. And so you can measure this. You can do experimental manipulations of model organisms like Drosophila and induce mutations. And most mutations, indeed, are detrimental, because they result in a detrimental change in gene product activity. But some mutations are beneficial, and it is those mutations that in some cases can lead to rapid evolution. We've already talked about the EPIS1 mutation in Tibetan populations, which allow the Tibetan human populations to adapt, have allowed them to adapt over a very short period of evolutionary time to high elevations, low oxygen content. And so there is a balance then between new variation generated by mutation and the variation, the beneficial variation that is generated by mutation. And remembering, of course, that mutations, being the ultimate source of genetic variation, of new alleles, in other words, can be recombined by the phenomenon of genetic crossing over in sexually reproducing organisms and independent assortment to provide new combinations of alleles at different genes that generates huge amounts of genetic variation that then can natural selection can act upon. So that is where we will end our discussion of mutation, and now we'll move on to regulation of gene expression and the various ways that that can occur in both prokaryotes and eukaryotes.